This morning we'll continue to look at the Westminster Confession of Faith, Chapter 3, on God's Eternal Decree, and this time looking at Sections 3 and 4, which read as follows. By the decree of God for the manifestation of His glory, some men and angels are predestinated unto everlasting life, and others foreordained to everlasting death. These angels and men, thus predestinated and foreordained, are particularly and unchangeably designed, and their number so certain and definite that it cannot be either increased or diminished. I suppose we're not used to thinking about angels as being elect, and yet the scriptures indicate in numerous places that there are elect angels. God has chosen some of the angels, the grand cohort of angels. He has chosen some to be His servants, while the remainder He has passed by. And in time, of course, we know that the angels had a moment when some participated in a rebellion against God. Unlike humanity, angels are created individually and separately. They do not have a line of descendants as we do. We have union in our humanity in Adam and Eve. But the angels are separate and different. And so they each stand or fall on their own merits. And so those who disobey must be punished for their sin, their rebellion. Those who continue in obedience would be blessed. In some respects, you can say, here is works of salvation in the raw, unfiltered. In humanity, that changes in that we have a head and representative, Adam, who acts for us. And his rebellion against God brought sin upon all of humanity, not just a portion of it. We all participate in that sin. And God, by His grace, is able to separate some within that mass of humanity for Himself, choosing them in Christ, the second Adam, the head of a new humanity. And so we are joined and united to Christ and saved through Him. So there is provision of salvation for the elect people of God, whereas for angels there is no provision. They stand or fall on their own merits. God has chosen who would remain faithful and those who would rebel against Him. And so Jesus, in talking about the end of time, He says that He will come with all the elect angels, reminding us there that there are some who are chosen to be His servants throughout all of human history. And just as there are some who are elect as angels, who are set apart for God and for His service, so also some men are also predestinated to everlasting life. God is pleased to select some out of the whole of humanity. He foresees who they would be. He knows them as His own. He sets them apart for Himself and joins them to Christ. Christ enters into the world to be their Savior. He undertakes their salvation. His death on the cross was designed for their liberation from sin. The sending of the Holy Spirit is designed for them so that they might be regenerated and enabled to trust in Christ. God works for the salvation of these elect and for them alone. The remainder of humanity, God is pleased to pass by and allow them to suffer the consequences of their sin. There are numerous texts of Scripture that we could refer to, but I'd like to direct your attention to one in the book of Romans, where the Apostle Paul addresses God's work of election, the sovereign work. In Romans chapter 9, he writes, "What if God, willing to show His wrath and to make His power known, endured with much longsuffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, and that He might make known the riches of His glory on the vessels of mercy, which He had afore prepared unto glory?" Paul, looking at the history of humanity, says that God has been pleased to pass by many who are foreordained to destruction. They are vessels of wrath. They are the objects of God's wrath for the revelation of this justice, whereby God will be satisfied in punishing their sins in themselves, just as fallen angels will be punished for their rebellion, so also fallen humanity will be punished for their sins. And in this way, God will be glorified in the revelation of this justice and wrath. God must punish his sin to remain just. At the same time, there are vessels of mercy, those whom God has set apart for himself, to be the objects of his mercy and grace, those who will be redeemed, so that at the end of history, when we all gather before God, God's justice will be manifested as well as his mercy and grace. His justice will be revealed in all of humanity, in the wicked, in their punishment, in the saved through their redemption in Christ, the righteousness being satisfied in Christ. And so there are those who are set apart for him in eternity past. These angels and men thus predestinated and foreordained are particularly and unchangeably designed, and their number so certain and definite that it cannot be either increased or diminished. Why is the confession so concerned about the number of the elect, that it cannot be changed? Is God stubborn? Is he going to resist those who clamor for him to save them? Not in the least. None of those whom God has set apart for destruction will desire to come to God, or desire to be saved on God's terms. None of them will come to Christ and humble themselves before him, abandoning their sins and trusting themselves to Christ alone. No, they do not want that. They are opposed to that. They will resist that. And at the very end of history, when Christ returns, they will cry out for their rocks to cover them. They will not repent before the coming Lamb of God. They will resist him. They will hide from him. They will run from him. Even in the manifestation of his judgment and wrath, they will run and hide rather than plead for mercy and grace. The number of the elect will not change. How many will there be? Well, on the one hand, there will be many. There will be vast numbers of those who gather around the throne of God to glorify and praise him for his mercy and grace. At the same time, Jesus says that the way is broad that leads to destruction, and many are they that follow it. But narrow is the road, and straight is the gate to life, and few there be that find it. Many are called, but few are chosen. So in the broad expanse of humanity, it would seem that God has a remnant of that humanity set apart for himself for salvation. God's plan is sovereign and gracious and good. And if you are set apart by God and his grace, then you may rejoice that you are included among the number of God's elect, and that cannot be changed. If he set you apart for himself, included you in Christ, then that salvation cannot be lost. You cannot lose your election. You cannot abandon your walk with Christ. Christ will himself keep you and bring you safely into his eternal kingdom. Your salvation is God's sovereign, gracious work. And as we reflected on last week, he who began a good work within you will bring it to completion